Yeah, I hope you're having a wonderful day. I'm here to talk about my process for collaborative debugging and why debugging is a human-centered issue as much as it is a technical one. So first, I'm Jackie. I'm an engineer at Square. Just a few months ago, though, I was working at a startup called Nihilus, who is actually sponsoring here today. You should say hi to them sometime. They're awesome. And I'm just going to tell a little bit story about two different bugs that we had at Nihilus and how we dealt with them, one where we used collaborative debugging and one where we didn't. So for some background, we kept this running list of customer issues that were reported by developers on our API. Our list of bugs get pretty long, as you can see. And I don't know what fixing bugs is like where all of you work, but at Nihilus it could be pretty rough for a couple reasons. I like this quote a lot. I used to have this idea that writing the code was like the real work, whatever that means. And as people with any kind of experience know, that's not actually the case. Sure, you have to write code, but you also need to, you know, refactor and delete code, think of and write the right test cases, and of course debug code. A lot of the bugs that we had gotten were reported with little to no data about how users were experiencing them, and so it fell on us as engineers to pull together the scraps of information and identify the root problem, which could take days or even weeks. So here was the first bug in emoji form, the one where we weren't collaborating in our debugging. User A would send user B an update to a calendar invite, and then user B would have the duplicate events showing on their calendar. So here's the task we created. We had two reports of the bug and a screenshot of someone's calendar, so confirming that this is actually happening. And since this was like a pretty serious issue for the company that reported the bug, we bumped it to the top of our customer issues list. So if we look at the activity on this task, we can see that someone created it on August 14th, when the bug was reported. And then 2 weeks later, an engineer was assigned to investigate it. She looked into it for a couple days, didn't find a fix, and then the next week, I was on bug fixing duty, and so I decided to look into it. I started with the logs, and there was nothing. We only kept logs for 2 weeks, and the bug had been reported a month ago at this point, so I spent the day sort of looking into whether, you know, I could reproduce it, I couldn't, and this is me investigating, sorry. I couldn't, and I reported back and said I couldn't reproduce, and I needed like more information to continue the investigation. And so I moved on to fix a couple other bugs and started working on a different project the next week. And as you can probably guess, I never ended up fixing this bug, which is sad. So what was wrong with this process? Well, first there was too little information about what users were doing to run into this issue. We needed more data points to be able to reproduce the bug. The next problem was that we actually missed the window for checking the logs. We only store logs for 2 weeks, so that two-week window is like a crucial period of time to make sure that we could find out where the error was getting thrown. And the last problem, in my opinion, the biggest one, was that we actually repeated work between investigations. How? Another engineer looked at the problem for 3 days. Even if she didn't find a fix, she still investigated, tested a few of her hypotheses, and found out which of them were wrong. But I didn't have any of that information when I started my investigation. And so later when I actually raised this issue at an all hands, we found out that there was actually a third engineer who had never actually claimed the task, so she wasn't on the task activity, but she had looked into it for like a couple days also and had never really found like a root cause, and so she, you know, didn't claim it on Fabricator. In short, we weren't working collaboratively, and we weren't sharing the data that we'd gathered because we just didn't think it was useful. So enter collaborative debugging. What does that mean? Everyone was sort of operating under this assumption that each person should claim a bug and fix it in sort of one stretch. But that's a faulty assumption for a lot of reasons. A lot of the hardest bugs don't actually work that way. They require like longer investigations and more people with different knowledge of the code base looking at the problem. And besides that, it can be really frustrating to work on a bug nonstop for days without making any sort of visible progress. So splitting the work kind of allows people to tag on and tag off and, you know, work on different projects and sort of refresh themselves. If we had been debugging collaboratively, each person would have been leaving behind breadcrumbs for the next person to make sure as little progress was lost as possible between people. So what would be a better debugging process? The first is just getting more information from the user reporting the bug. And collaborative debugging is really like also about collaborating with support, not just engineering. The second is pulling stack traces from the logs as soon as possible. And the person can doing that, again, can be in support. Like, if they look at the logs, as soon as they get the bug report, they can just drop the stack trace into the task that they create. And there's somewhere in the code that an engineer can pick up whenever they can actually get to the task. And finally, the last part is just documenting progress, good or bad, in the investigation, which is kind of what I was saying in the last slide about leaving breadcrumbs. We had this pervasive idea that the findings from our investigations were only valuable if they just led directly to the root problem. But it actually turns out people have really similar thought processes, and we'll sort of try the same hypotheses over and over again and follow the same paths to try to diagnose an issue. And so if you have a hypothesis that was wrong, it's useful for the next person to know that so that they don't test it again. So we took all of what we learned and created a process around it. And let's see how that looks in practice. This is the second bug, also emoji form, where we actually did try using collaborative debugging. This is just a bug where users would send an email through our API, request the, like, raw message, which we stored in S3, and they would consistently get a 404 back. So here's the task we created. First, we got the right information from the user. So there was a pretty clear four-step process to reproducing the issue. And a lot of that reproducibility is luck, right? But you can't necessarily have that for every bug, but that helped a lot. It was really important. We knew exactly which endpoints they were hitting and what was happening when they did, which is great. And here's the initial activity on the task. We created it on September 11th, and an engineer got to it within 2 weeks. So we still had the logs and could find where we were throwing the error, as you can see right here at the bottom, this section. And so the engineer started investigating and documented her progress. Here we can see she thought it might have been a race condition issue with S3, but that turned out to not be the case. And so that prevents anyone else from trying to go down that dead end in the future. And here was the full course of her investigation. It took a few days, and she traced all of her thought processes, what she tried, what worked, what didn't work, and eventually what the problem was. After a few days, she had a rough idea of the next steps, but she actually had to leave on vacation. So I took over the bug fix. And because I had all the necessary context, I was able to continue the last part of the investigation, implement the fix, and deploy it without any issues. So essentially, collaborative debugging enabled us to fix this second bug where we couldn't fix the first one, and we got to carry over work between multiple people. The customer who reported the bug was happy, and we felt good that we made progress on the issue. There was a similar anecdote with my friend who worked at Lyft after I told her about this sort of process that we were following. And similarly, they had an engineer leave the company like midway through an investigation, left the company, and they were just able to pick right up and, you know, ship and deploy the fix that the engineer had been working on because they had been keeping track of all their progress through the investigation. So my big takeaway from this story is just that not every problem is technical in nature. We, for instance, discussed storing the logs for like a longer period of time, which is something we could have done, doubled it from 2 weeks to a month, say. But someone still needs to get to the logs eventually for that to work. So in the end, we sort of saw this as like a people problem and a process problem and not a technical problem. In short, changing the way that we thought about debugging and actively thinking about bug fixes as like longer-term, collaborative, and like asynchronous efforts made the experience a lot better for everyone. And that's all. Feel free to say hi on Twitter. I'm Jackie Liu. Thanks.